Welcome to the first lecture of Economics and Management. In today's lecture, we will cover these topics. We will see brief introduction about the subject. We will talk about what is objective and scope of the course. We will see few definitions that we are going to use throughout this course. And we will see what is competition and what are the types of competition. In today's lecture, we will only talk about demand definition, but demand types and demand function we will see in a next lecture. So let's start with the introduction of this subject. So the subject says economics and management. So what is the meaning of economics? Economics broadly deals with the aspect of social science that analyzes production, distribution, and consumption of goods and services. So what is meaning of it? Let's take one example of a farmer who is producing a rice. So what is meaning of production, distribution, consumption? The amount of rice the farmer has produced comes under production under given circumstances, under given natural conditions, where the farmer is distributing his rice and how he is distributing his rice, whether he is distributing his rice to the local market or to the city market, or whether he is exporting the rice, and the way he is distributing the rice, and the consumption of that rice, who is consuming that rice. Now in this case, there are two conditions: whether that farmer is producing rice for his own consumption or whether he is producing rice for the selling. So this is one simple example that we can give to understand the meaning of production, distribution, consumption. Okay, now whenever we are talking about economics having so many branches. For example, social economics, for example, political economics, for example, environmental economics, and so on. There are two main branches of economics. First is microeconomics and second is macroeconomics. Now, what is meaning of macroeconomics? Whenever we are talking about economics in general, like the profit of nation, the growth of nation, the employment rate of nation, the poverty in nation, then that is known as a macroeconomics. Now, what is meaning of microeconomics? Whenever we are talking about economics in respect with a small firm or an individual, the profit of a small firm or the profit of individual, or what decisions the firm should take so that its profit will get increased, or how the resources that firm should use so that the profit of firm will get increased, these decisions and these concepts comes under the title microeconomics. Now we will talk about management. What is the meaning of management? Management is act of getting people together to accomplish desired goals and objectives using available resources efficiently and effectively. Now there are two keywords: using resources efficiently and effectively. So let me give you one example of this this situation. For example, let's say there is one firm in which 100 people are working every day to get some profit X. Now in this pandemic situation, we have to maintain a social distance, so 100 people can't come to work at a time. So only 20% workers are allowed to come to the work every day. Now how that firm will manage human resources so that the profit will get increased, or at least they will get same profit as they were getting profit previously when there were 100 people working together. So this is, we can say, a management. That firm is managing human resources efficiently and effectively. So this is example of management. Now there are so many branches of management: operational management, product management, process management, human resource management. So these are a few branches of management. That is not our concern, but this is all about management. Now the next course objective. Being a technical student, the question that may come in your mind is that what is need of this particular subject to our branch? or to any branch. So what is the need of economics and management? So what happens in this course? This course is basically to enable a student to appreciate the role of economics and management in starting and running a new enterprise. So the knowledge of economics and management will help you to start your own enterprise, to run your own enterprise with good profit. Not only to run, but run in a way in which you will get more profit. So this is our course objective. Now the next. What is scope of this subject? Where we are going to limit this subject? Because both economics and management, both are different subjects and both are very vast. So what is scope of this subject? First is, we shall limit the aspect of economics that we will cover to those aspects that are applied only at firm level. Okay, so in this case, generally we are going to talk about microeconomics. Principles of management will be limited to those that are applied to a decision making at a firm level, say. And the coverage of subject will be introductory in nature. Like I have told you, there are so many branches of economics, social economics, environmental economics, but that is not our concern. And again, there are so many branches of management, like resource management, operational management, product management, process management. Again, that is not our concern. We are going to see this subject only in an introductory nature and the aspect of subject that are only applicable at the firm level. Now, next, we are going to see some definitions that we are going to use throughout this course. So the first definition is market. A market is a kind of arrangement where buyers and sellers interact to exchange various types of things such as goods, services, stocks, contract, and so on. Again, there are two keywords in this definition: interact and exchange. How the buyers and sellers interact with each other and the way of exchange, how they are exchanging the things or goods or services or stocks or contracts. So this is the definition of market. Now the next definition is demand. What is the meaning of demand? The quantity of commodity or the amount of product or service that person is willing and able to buy under given sort of conditions. Again, there are two keywords. First is willing to buy and second is able to buy. Now, to understand this, let's take one example. Let's say I want to buy an iPhone. Now, I am willing to buy an iPhone. Okay, so one condition is satisfied, willing. Now, second question, am I able to buy that iPhone? So, if in this case, I am willing to buy iPhone, but I am not having sufficient amount of money in my account, so I am not able to buy that iPhone, so the desire of buying iPhone not becomes my demand. Now let's say one more condition. Let's say I am having sufficient money in my account to buy an iPhone, but I am not willing, I am not interested to buy an iPhone. So again, I am able to buy, but I am not willing to buy. So both conditions are not satisfied. So that thing of buying iPhone doesn't make my demand. Now let's say I am willing to buy iPhone. I have desire to buy iPhone. I am having sufficient amount of money in my account. So I am able to buy iPhone. So now in this case, that desire of buying iPhone becomes my demand. But again, there is third keyword. First, what is that? Service that a person is willing and able to buy under given sort of conditions. Now in third case, I am willing to buy iPhone, I am able to buy iPhone, but that iPhone is not available into the market. So that is the condition. The iPhone is not available into the market. So again, though I am willing and able, due to some sort of conditions, the iPhone is not available. But what is the perfect case? When I am willing to buy iPhone, when I am able to buy iPhone, and iPhone is also available into the market. So that desire of buying iPhone becomes my demand. So this is definition of demand. Now the third definition is supply. What is the meaning of supply? The quantity of a product or a service that firm makes available to the market for sale under given set of market conditions. So whenever any firm or any individual or any company makes some product available for selling, then that becomes supply. I have given you example of farmer. The farmer can produce rice or commodity for his own consumption or for selling. Whenever he is producing it for his own consumption, that doesn't become a supply. But whenever he is producing it for selling, then that will become supply. So this is what supply. Now the next condition is, or the next definition is, market equilibrium. A perfect balance of demand and supply in a market, we say that the market is in equilibrium. Whenever there is a perfect balance of demand and supply into the market, then we will say that market is in a equilibrium. So whenever demand equals to supply, we will say the market is in equilibrium. Now the next. Now we will talk about competition and what are the types of competitions. Now see, every market is having competition. Now there are two types of competitions. First is perfect competition and second is imperfect competition. So we will see in next slide in detail. But at this moment, keep in mind, every market is having some sort of competition. Everywhere there is a competition. There are two types of competitions: perfect competition, imperfect competition. There are few types of imperfect competition, like monopoly competition, oligopoly competition, bilateral monopoly competition, monopsony, and so on. So we will see in detail about these competitions in next slide. So this is a table that will explain the types of competitions. Now, while explaining every type of competition, I will give you some examples. That examples are in general, that are not mentioned anywhere, that I have created for you to understand the concept in a better manner. Now the first is perfect competition. What is the meaning of perfect competition? When there are many buyers and many sellers and the product is homogeneous. What is the meaning of product is homogeneous? The type of product is same. Now the knowledge. When both buyers and sellers having perfect knowledge about the product and freedom of entry and exit, there is a complete entry for buyers as well as sellers into the market. So this is known as perfect competition. What happens in perfect competition? There are many buyers, there are many sellers, the product is homogeneous, both buyers and sellers having perfect knowledge about the product, and there is a perfect entry or full entry or complete entry for buyers and sellers into the market. So this is the perfect competition. For example, let's say we are going into the sabji market. So what happens? There are many buyers who are buying the sabji. There are many sellers who are selling the sabji, and the product is homogeneous. Like whenever we are buying, we can say a potato, there is no branding of potato. Every potato is same, right? So product is homogeneous. And knowledge, both buyer and seller is having knowledge about the potato. Freedom of entry and exit. Anyone can enter into the market to buy a potato and anyone can sell a potato. So this is perfect competition. Now there is second type, imperfect competition. Now there are a few types of imperfect competition. So the first is monopoly. What is the meaning of monopoly, imperfect competition? There are many buyers and there is only one seller. The product is homogeneous, the same product. Knowledge, both buyer and seller is having knowledge about the product. And freedom of complete, there is no freedom for seller into the market. For example, there is a restricted entry for the sellers. There is a restricted entry into the market. For example, let's take one example to understand this concept into a better manner. So first of all, let me repeat what is monopoly. What happens in monopoly? There are many buyers, one seller, product is homogeneous, both buyer and seller is having knowledge about the product, and there is a restricted entry. What is the meaning of restricted entry? And how I can explain this? So let me give you one example. So the example is, before 1991, in telecom industry, there were no entry for the private companies in India. Pay attention carefully. Before 1991, in telecom industry, there were no entry for private companies into a telecom industry. So there was only one to two telecom industries which were governed by the government. For example, BSNL. So BSNL was the only service provider of telecom industry. There were many buyers who were using service from the BSNL. So in this case, BSNL was the only seller who was providing a telecom service. There were many buyers who were using service of the BSNL. The product was homogeneous, that is telecom service. Knowledge, both buyer and seller were having knowledge about the telecom service. And restricted entry means what? The private companies were not allowed to enter into the telecom industry in India before 1991. But after 1991, the scenario changed. There were some economic reforms and private companies get entry. But we can explain this taking into consideration the situation of before 1991. So I hope you understand it. Now next is monopolistic competition. What is the meaning of it? There are many buyers, there are many sellers. The product is differentiated. What is the meaning of product is differentiated? There are different brands. Both buyers and sellers having knowledge about the product. And there is a complete entry for buyers as well as sellers into the market. For example, let's take example of phone. There are many buyers of phones, there are many sellers of phones. And product is differentiated means there are various brands like Nokia, Samsung, Apple, and knowledge. Both buyer and seller is having knowledge about the product. And there is a complete entry. Any company can enter into this, or any buyer can buy a phone. So complete entry. Now the next is oligopoly. What is the meaning of oligopoly? Imperfect competition. There are many buyers, there are few sellers. The product is homogeneous or differentiated, and both having knowledge about the product, and there is a restricted entry for a seller. For example, there are many buyers and there are few sellers. The product is homogeneous. Okay, so now let me give you an example of there is a one group of country who is selling oil. So now every country requires oil. So there are many buyers for buying oil. Now few sellers, not every country can sell oil. Okay, not every country can sell oil. There are few group of countries who are selling the oil. So the sellers are few. Now product is homogeneous or differentiated. They can sell a same type of oil or they can sell differentiated oil. Okay, what is the meaning of differentiated? There can be brands or there can be types. For example, crude oil, processed oil, likewise. And both buyer and sellers having knowledge about the product. Now, and the freedom of entry and exit. There is a restricted entry for sellers, only for sellers. Why? Because not every country can produce oil and not every country can sell oil, but almost every country can buy oil. So there is a freedom for buyers, but there is a restricted entry for sellers. So this is example of oligopoly. Now the next is bilateral monopoly. What is the meaning of bilateral monopoly? There is one buyer and one seller. The product is homogeneous. Both buyer and seller having knowledge about the product, and there is a restricted entry for the seller. Now, how we can explain this bilateral monopoly? For example, the YONO SBI app used by SBI, State Bank of India, means there is a one buyer of that app, that is SBI, and seller. Only one company or only one firm is producing that app. So seller is also one. The product is homogeneous, okay? There is no branding of YONO or there are no types of YONOs. So the product is homogeneous. And both buyer and seller is having knowledge about the product. Both SBI knows what they want from YONO and both seller know what they are going to provide through YONO. And there is a restricted entry. Not every company or not every firm is producing YONO app. Only the single firm is producing YONO app. So this is what bilateral monopoly. Now the next is monopsony imperfect competition. What is meaning of it? There is a one buyer there are many sellers, the product is homogeneous, both buyer and seller having knowledge about the product, and there is a complete entry for both buyer and seller. Now let me give you example of this monopsony. For example, I want to buy or I want to build a home, so I am the only buyer I am the only one who wants to build my home, and there are many sellers. Means what? There can be many people who will help me or who will sell me homes or who will help me to build my home, or there we can say contractors. So I am the only buyer and there can be so many contractors. The product is homogeneous, that is, I want home. Home is a single product. Knowledge, both me and that contractor is having knowledge about the product, and there is a freedom of complete entry and exit. There can be so many contractors come in my contact to tell me, ma'am, I can buy the I can sell the home. So this is example of monopsony. And the last one is oligopsony. What is meaning of this? There are few buyers, there are many sellers, the product is homogeneous, the knowledge, both buyer and seller is having knowledge about the product, and there is a complete freedom of entry and exit. So what is meaning of it? Let's say there are so many countries who are, okay, let's not take example, okay, let's take example, this perfect example. Let's say there are so many countries who are selling sugar or who is exporting the sugar, but not every country wants to buy it because India is producing its own sugar, China is producing its own sugar, so they won't import sugar, right? So there are few countries who wants to import sugar, but there are so many countries who want to export the sugar. So the product is homogeneous again. The sugar is a product. There is no branding. There are no types of sugars. Knowledge, both buyer and seller having knowledge about the product, and freedom of entry and exit. There is a complete freedom of entry and exit for both buyer and seller. So this is what we have talked about, competition and types of competitions. I hope you understand this. So for today, we will stop here. In next lecture, we will talk about what is demand and types of demands and demand function and so on. Thank you so much.